Saturated skies and a water-soaked field greeted the L.D. Bell Blue Raiders as they kicked off their 1986 football season. A less-than-sterling performance still provided a 19-14 triumph over Newman Smith and prepped the Raiders for district play in week two of the season against the always-strong Arlington Colts. The ultimate 35-32 slugfest victory only encouraged the Blue Raiders, their coaches, and their fans to dream. To dream of a well-balanced offensive attack, a pounding defensive unit, and a solid specialty team. All combining to form that perfect Cinderella mix of an undefeated season and a state championship. But dreams are often shattered. In week three, mental lapses, lady luck, and a solid Lamar Viking team dealt the Blue Raiders a stinging blow, 7-6. A missed last-second field goal attempt meant that one dream was over, but a new one had to begin. Week four took Bell to UTA's Maverick Stadium to face the surprising and undefeated Martin Warriors. Momentarily out of the playoff picture so early in the season, the Raiders put an entire game together to crush the Warriors 16-3. Bursting their bubble of invincibility and sending them tumbling to the bottom of the District 7-5A standings, for Bell, the performance was a confidence builder, which created dreams of better things to come. Weeks 5 and 6 proved to be turning points. Both offensive and defensive units developed their personalities, first against Sam Houston, and then Burleson in aerial flair. Fleet footwork and bone-jarring tackles became Blue Raider trademarks. Bell trimmed the Texans 38-20 and then bounced Burleson 38-0. Game-breaking plays such as David McFarland's 91-yard interception return for a touchdown against Sam became commonplace. The following week, Bell defeated the Richland Rebels 30-7 as offensive and defensive units began to gel, and in week 9, the Blue Raiders got their earliest lead ever against the Halton Buffaloes with a touchback after only 4 seconds. McFarland again provided the thrills on the ensuing free kick. Ultimately, the Blue Raiders with Brian Delbridge's 3-yard touchdown run and with linebacker Paul Chabay's pressure defense leading the way, defeated the Buffaloes 25-6, and 1 week later stopped a scrappy Grapevine team 28-21. Only by defeating Trinity, then having the Trojans defeat Lamar, could the Blue Raiders dream of entering the playoffs. This time, Lady Luck smiled, and the Bell fans came home to Texas Stadium.
Going into the playoffs, we drew a tough opponent, Duncanville, who had just suffered a loss at the end of the season, a team that had been rated in the top 10 most, if not all, of the year. So we were really apprehensive about playing them after they had been stung by the bee the week before, because we knew they were going to be angry. Had just a premier performance by our defense and also by our offense. Our prime objective was to take the ball out of the hands of the fullback and the tailback by double teaming them and make their quarterback run. It was a great defensive game plan designed by Coach Jack Gibson and his staff, Mark Ball and Paul Smith, and our players really executed it well.
Letter perfect execution developed on Duncanville's first series as the Blue Raiders stopped the Panthers' entire offensive game. The sweep, power up the middle, and the passing game. When Bell got the ball, they traveled 18 yards in 5 plays before Kerry Blanchard booted a 44-yard field goal to put the Raiders ahead 3-0. On the first play of Bell's second series, Duncanville capitalized on a Blue Raider fumble on the 25-yard line. However, the Bell defense held again, and Duncanville attempted a 37-yard field goal attempt, which was short. With the defense taking a breather, Bell's offense cranked into gear. The Blue Raiders used a balanced running and passing attack to travel 80 yards in 18 plays. And Paul Chabay took the touchdown in from 1 yard to give Bell a 10-0 lead at the half. When Duncanville first got the ball in the second half, they began their comeback. The Panthers traveled 61 yards in only 4 plays, both through the air and on the fleet feet of blue chip running back Barry Foster, who traveled the final 29 yards for their counter. Bell 10, Duncanville 8. A solid kickoff return was nullified 2 plays later by yet another Bell fumble and Duncanville recovery, this time on the Blue Raider 44. An aerial bomb and a 1 yard plunge put Duncanville in the driver's seat, 14-10. Bell's offense flirted with disaster on a fumbled lateral, but in the next series, a 63-yard bullet from Jamie Gill to William Archer put the Blue Raiders back in front, 17-14. Both teams would score again in the fourth quarter, including Brian Delbridge's 3-yard journey. With Duncanville eliminated 24-20, it was onward to round two of the playoffs against Denton in the regionals.
The Denton Broncos have been in the playoffs the previous 5 years. Comparing the talent with Duncanville and Denton, there was not very much of a drop-off between the two teams. So I was scared that our drop-off mentally would not compensate for their drop-off talent-wise. So again, I was very pleased with our kids playing a tremendous game, and Bryant Vaughn got things going with a great catch early. Our defense came out, played 3 great plays, got the ball in excellent field position, and Jamie hit Bryant on a deep route down the 3-yard line. The momentum of the game changed about midway between the second and third quarters. It changed to Denton's side, but again, showed you the type of character our ball club had and came back and won another tough playoff game after beating a team that was a very highlighted game the week before.
Bell's defense allowed the Blue Raider offense to start working on Denton's 49-yard line. Gill's pass to Vaughn, a deep route down the sideline, carried for 36 yards. And Brian Delbridge picked up the final yards over left tackle for the game's first score. Bell led 7-0. Lacking Bell's sizzle, the Broncos had 2 sustained drives fall short, salvaging 2 field goals, Bell 7, Denton 6. Bell countered with a 12-play, 86-yard drive. Brian Delbridge spun for 9 around left end. Terry slashed for six up the middle, setting up a perfectly executed sideline pattern from Gill to Archer for 16 yards. Brian Delbridge ran around and through the Bronco defense on two plays that netted 15 yards. Then he caught a 12-yard pass from Gill. Another Gill toss, this time to Wade Parkhill, carried the Raiders to the two. Fittingly, Delbridge got the score, putting Bell ahead 14-6 with the first half clock running down. Bell took the second half kickoff and faltered, resorting to a fake fourth down punt. Jason Shauver's 30-yard scamper got the first down, but the drive faltered. Kerry Blanchard stepped in, booting a 50-yard field goal to put the Blue Raiders ahead 17-6. Following a sustained drive for a Denton touchdown, Bell got another third quarter field goal on a Gill to Archer completion for 55 yards. Again, Blanchard provided the kick. Bell 20, Denton 12. One other drive by the Blue Raiders put the game out of reach when Jamie Gill performed sleight of hand for the insurance TD. Once again, the Blue Raiders outlasted a larger, faster team. Now, Bell faced the Amarillo Sandies during Thanksgiving holidays for the right to be called regional champs.
Viewing the films of the Amarillo team, we felt like they would be a different ball club against us than they had been in the films because they had lost their great running back, Timmy Smith. We felt like that they would throw the ball as they had done the previous week against El Paso a large number of times. The experience that we received in the Sam Houston and Grapevine game were very beneficial to our defensive ball club. I did not work on the mental aspect with the team as much as I had the week before against Denton and the previous 2 weeks with Grapevine and Duncanville. I went after it in a more of a business-like atmosphere. The team played this way, and we were definitely a better physical ball club than Amarillo, as the viewers could see. We made a few mistakes offensively, but defensively it was one of the toughest hitting ball games that we've been around. David McFarland was unbelievable, created a number of turnovers. Again, we took care of business in a week that was a business-like week.
For the Blue Raider defense, it was taking care of business as usual. Jeff Bradford stopped the Sandies' opening drive by causing a fumble that Paul Chabay was glad to recover. Jamie Gill combined with a leaping William Archer for 37 yards to the Amarillo 11. Brian Delbridge knifed to the 4. Then Terry carried it to the 1. Before going airborne for the touchdown with 7:12 to go in the first quarter. But again, it was a big play defense controlling the tempo of the game. First by swarming Amarillo's running attack. Then by jarring the Sandy's passing game. The specialty teams had their shining moments also, such as Nate DeBoer's one-handed block of a punt. A Bradford interception completed a frustrating first half for the outgained Amarillo team as Bell took a halftime 10-0 lead to the locker rooms. The Sandys found no halftime magic as their first series ended with another fumble recovered by DeBoard. In the third quarter, the Blue Raiders continued to shine, first with great runs by Brad Myers. With sparkling punt returns by the amazing David McFarland. And with the touchdown scoring acrobatics of Brian Delvish. It was McFarland, number 21, whose crunching defensive plays epitomized the dominance of Vail as the Blue Raiders ground the Amarillo Sandstorm into the Texas Stadium turf, 24-7. For LD Vail, it was on to the quarterfinals against the tradition of the awesome Coyotes from Wichita Falls and their powerful single-wing offense.
Wichita Falls has as great a tradition as any high school in the state of Texas. They also have a great stadium in Wichita Falls, and I knew that Coach Tyler would love to get us out of Texas Stadium to Wichita Falls and play. I discussed with Mr. Brown, our principal, that we needed to go for a neutral site, Falls Field being an excellent location. We agreed, between the two schools agreed, that we should play in Denton. It's a beautiful stadium, beautiful color with the umbrellas, beating the rain beating down off the umbrellas, and it was a tremendous football game. But I think the strategic move by us was not to flip home and home and take a chance of having to play Wichita Falls in their backyard. So we felt very good about where we agreed to play and how the players played after the first quarter.
However, the first quarter was a different story. With the weather conditions favoring Wichita Falls single-wing power running over Bell's finesse running and pinpoint passing, it looked like it would be a long night for the Raiders and their fans. The opening kickoff and the Coyotes' first series showcased their premier running back, 6'2", 215-pound Eric Chapman, whose size and speed camouflaged his effectiveness. Wichita Falls called Chapman's number to either side with equal effectiveness. As the Raiders grasped air and bounced off Chapman, the Coyotes began a 10-minute drive that covered 90 yards in 15 plays. Chapman's toughness rubbed off on fellow wingback Roger Poland, number 25. But when the Bell defense stiffened, the Coyotes, facing a 4th and 10 on the Blue Raider 22, went back to Chapman, who glided, twisted, and turned until he hit pay dirt. When the Blue Raiders finally got the ball, the Coyote defense, cold, wet playing conditions, and frustration led to a short series and a punt. The Big Red Machine was back in business. Poland knife for 12 yards. And as the second quarter started, it was Chapman's power and persistence that paved the way, first for 19 yards. And then for the score. Two penalty flags for illegal blocking proved to be of no avail as Chapman became a passer, tossing to Chuck Smith for the second Coyote score. However, the cold and the rain and the hard hitting of the Raiders started to take a toll on Wichita Falls. Midway through the second quarter, on Only Bell's second possession, it was gut check time for the men in blue. Gill hit Archer for 16 yards. Brian Terry sprinted left for 6. Then Delbert rambled 41 yards, the Coyote 5. Delbridge then bounced to the one. Brian Delbridge, Bell's Mr. Everything, edged into the end zone. Bell was on the scoreboard after 10 plays and 77 yards. The momentum was wearing a Blue Raider jersey. Following Coach Jack Gibson's defensive adjustments, the Blue Raiders began to stop Chapman, and the ever-increasing Coyote penalties caused Wichita Falls to punt. Lightning was about to strike the Coyotes in the form of Brad Myers, who returned the kick 62 yards for the tying score. The halftime score, a surprising Bell 14, Wichita Falls 14. The Blue Raiders had held on throughout a tough first half. Now, despite less than perfect playing conditions, Bell was ready to rumble.
The turf was extremely good for that type of weather. It absorbed the moisture. It was not slick. It had good footing. And I thought Jamie performed excellent in throwing the football. The player that had the game of the week was Brian Delbridge. He was super with his running and catching. And defense came back and really played a lot better in the second half than they did in the first half. And again, Brad Myers and Kerry Blanchard made great plays on our specialty teams, which had been so important through the year. And I think the key was a punt return, the great play of Delbridge, and the whole team playing well under adverse conditions.
As the second half began, the Coyotes knew the Blue Raiders would have the ball. With receiver Mike Sabascos grabbing hands and charging feet, Bell began its downfield march, aided by penalty-prone Wichita Falls' unnecessary roughness call. Then it was time for Brian Delbridge, first on a 23-yard pass from Jamie Gill. Then a pounding 9-yard run. Following a pass interference penalty, it was, who else, Brian Delbridge on a 1-yard plunge. L.D. Bell had retaliated with 21 unanswered points and led in the game for the first time 21-14. However, on a go-for-broke onside kick attempt that failed, Bell offered Wichita Falls a golden opportunity. The amazing Eric Chapman took only 7 plays to go 48 yards for the tying touchdown. The score was 21-all, but Bell's dream would diminish any doom and gloom attitude and turn it into one of a charmed life. Bell's second possession of the half would feature more Coyote personal fouls, thus spelling the beginning of the end for Wichita Falls. Then it was time again for Delbridge and company. First on a 36-yard toss and run from Gill. Then on an 11-yard jaunt to the Coyote 14. A rare Jamie Gill keeper put Bell on the 2. Then, as the final quarter began, Brian Terry launched Bell back into the lead, 28-21. What sealed the victory and a state semifinal berth was when Shebe and company, Bell's talented defense, found the secret to stopping Wichita Falls. Stop Eric Chapman. Facing 4th-and-7, Chapman was pounded by Richard Dugan and Kirk Robinson. A Kerry Blanchard 35-yard field goal on top of his four extra points rounded out the scoring and silenced the Coyote crowd 31-21. Wichita Falls had one last chance at redemption. Chapman, finding no open receiver, scampered for 25 yards, but it was to no avail when David McFarland intercepted Chapman's next pass. For Wichita Falls, defeat became disgrace. With a minute 21 remaining, referees called the game following a deliberate attack upon Bell center Dwayne Croker. For Bell, the Blue Raiders had beaten tradition and the unbeatable. They had stopped Wichita Falls. But this victory was only one in a season of memorable highlights. 1986 was a year that perhaps peaked in excitement in week number 7 when the Blue Raiders met special rival Trinity in shootout number 5 to determine the playoff teams for District 75A.
I felt like that it was a do or die as far as our football was concerned and going to the playoffs. We had to win the Trinity game. I knew the players knew that. The media was expounding upon that. So I tried to downplay it and use the little slogan, we're going to do our best and not sweat the rest all week. I tried to go about it in that way. You know, fortunately, we opened the game. We were very loose. We were very positive with our play calling. We were on the attack and jumped out to an astounding lead it had.
Once again, Texas Stadium provided the backdrop for the Bell Trinity game, this time during the 7th week of the season, rather than the traditional season-ending game. Bell led off with Brian Delbridge on the ground and the airborne Gill to Archer combination in an attempt to upset the undefeated Trojans. Then Brian Terry carried to the 12-yard line. And a penalty moved the ball to the 7. With 8:50 left in the first quarter, the Raiders opened the scoring on Delbridge's 3-yard touchdown run. On Trinity's first series, the Blue Raider defense dug in, stopping the powerful Trojan running attack in 3 plays and forcing a punt. The remainder of the first quarter provided time to tune up Bell's passing attack. First, Gill to Archer for 12 yards. Then Gill shoveled the ball to Delbridge for 4. Gill's receivers also included Bryant Vaughn for 13 yards. Action intensified in the second quarter when a stiff Trojan rush caused punter Brian Delbridge to scramble for whatever yardage he could get, providing Trinity with excellent field position at the Blue Raider 35. Trojan running back B.J. Weaver carried the ball 17 yards to the 18-yard line, and John Skinner scampered for 13 more to the 5. Quarterback Darren Schultz's end sweep deadlocked the game at 7 apiece. Perhaps Trinity celebrated 2 plays too long. Following the kickoff, Bell's precision air attack, Gill to Archer, caught the Trojans napping. To the tune of 83 yards and a touchdown, Bell 14, Trinity 7. Despite a good comeback drive by Trinity, Nate DeBoard, Paul Chabet, and Kevin Cox turned back Weaver on a 4th down and 4 play, offering Air Edwards one more flight to pay dirt. Senior quarterback Jamie Gill's golden arm made it happen. First, 17 yards to Wade Parkhill. Then 18 yards on a post pattern to Archer. Gill went to Terry for a 9-yarder. And finally, back to Parkhill for 20 yards and the touchdown. With one of Bell's best halves of football under their belts, the Blue Raiders carried a 21-7 advantage into the locker rooms. However, half number two provided a drastic change from the previous 24 minutes. Trinity would take the opening kickoff and drive 80 yards for a score, effectively putting the Trojans back in the game. Quarterback Darren Schultz scooted around right in to begin the Trojan comeback. John Skinner went off tackle for 7 yards before the Blue Raiders stiffened, forcing Trinity to settle for a 24-yard Bradderdale field goal. The score, Bell 21, Trinity 10. Two busted plays and one quick kick later, Trinity was back in business at their own 42-yard line. Coy Parker sped around left end for 21 yards to the Bell 38. And then B.J. Weaver rambled to the Blue Raider half-yard line. And on the next play, closed the gap to 21-16. Coach John Riddell's decision to go for the two-point conversion changed the game's outlook. Bell 21, Trinity 18, and closing. As the fourth quarter started, one more Blue Raider mistake put Trinity in the driver's seat on Bell's 36-yard line. Schultz took advantage by rocketing a picture-perfect sideline pass to Brad Riddell. B.J. Weaver's dive gave the Trojans a first down on the 1-yard line. Rising to the occasion, Bell's goal line defense twice stopped Weaver. On third down, Jeff Bradford forced Schultz into David McFarland, who dropped the Trojan quarterback for a 4-yard loss. Another Brad Riddell field goal, however, knotted the score at 21 apiece. With the prospect of a tie eliminating Bell from the playoffs and with 77 yards to travel for a score, it was time for quarterback Jamie Gill to kickstart the sleeping Blue Raider offense into action. Gill went to Vaughn for 10 yards. Then he tossed to Delbridge, who found William Archer at the Trinity 24. Delbridge then rambled past the 20-yard line. Then to the 15, where short yardage specialist Paul Chabay ran the clock down to 6 seconds with short bursts into the line to position the ball for record-setting kicker Kerry Blanchard and the opportunity to win it all.
Kerry Blanchard, after Trinity called a timeout, came over. And I've always, if I found a nickel during the week, well, I've, you know, put it in my pocket and use it as a good luck charm. That week, I'd found a dollar bill outside of my car, and I told Kerry about it and the team about it in a team meeting. As we knelt down, I looked at Kerry, and he was fiddling with his sock, and he had found a $5 bill, and he took it out and rubbed that $5 bill. I guess, you know, we were superstitious. We wanted to get all the luck we could, too. But it was a very pressure-packed ending, and that we knew a tie would virtually eliminate us from the playoffs, too. So after we kicked the field goal and won it, it was a really like a man getting a pardon from the electric chair. We had life again, and we were ready to go enjoy that life. 86 Blue Raiders were a group of young men that have always believed that they could win a state championship. But they took that belief and that confidence in themselves and they displayed it not only on the practice field, but in the weight rooms, in the classrooms, and on the Friday night and Saturday afternoon playing fields. A group that I've never enjoyed coaching another group as much or more than this bunch. They were just a joy to coach. They were a group of young men that always put team before themselves, and I think that's why they had the great success that they did.